Yes, ma'am.
There is no biological reason behind it. We are going to put the leaves that you have treated either on the tile or on a petri plate.
Yes,
if you put on petri plate or on tile, both of them are going to give you the same result.
Yes,
after putting it, you are going to pour iodine solution.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. So that iodine solution can spread all over the leaf.
Okay,
it can spread all over the leaf, and every part of the leaf is treated with iodine solution.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
Ma'am? Question, ma'am.
Yes?
Ma'am, why don't we put some another solution rather than iodine, ma'am?
Because we are testing starch, and starch is tested by iodine solution. And starch is the only product that is formed by the plant. Okay, starch is insoluble, first of all. And that is the only product that can be tested.
Thank you.
Hormones or phytohormones. There are five classes of hormone, phytohormone, that we find in plants. Out of them, three are growth promoting hormone, and the next two are growth inhibiting hormone. We have completed auxin and gibberellin. What is the main effect of auxin? It promotes growth. It shows apical dominance. It is a hormone that causes parthenocarpy. And it prevents abscission. These were four effect or physiological effect of hormone auxin. Now, if we see gibberellin was more potent than auxin for parthenocarpy. The main effect of gibberellin was that, what was the main effect? It increases internode distances. That is, it overcomes genetic dwarfism in the plant. Now suppose if you have sugarcane, okay, and the internodes are small, what will happen? The sugar content of the sugarcane will lower down. So in such cases, you need to increase the distance between the two nodes, or in such plant you will have to overcome genetic dwarfism, which is done with the help of gibberellin. 100 types of gibberellin are there, out of which GA3 is most common. Gibberellic acid or gibberellin delays aging. Aging in plants is also known as senescence. Okay, so it delays senescence. Clear? Now we'll start with cytokinin, the third growth promoting hormone. It was discovered cytokinin. Ninen is written, is abbreviated as capital C and small k, cytokinin. Okay, gibberellic acid is GA, auxin is IAA, natural auxin, endolacetic acid or auxin, gibberellic acid, and CK. This is most common gibberellic acid found in higher plants. Now, cytokinin was discovered by Skoog and Miller in 1950. It is produced in meristem. Meristem are the places where division take place, okay, which can undergo mitosis. Three meristem are there, if you remember: apical, lateral, and intercalary. So cytokinin promotes or increases division in meristematic tissue as well as non-meristematic tissue. Have you understood? Cytokinin is effective for meristematic as well as non-meristematic part of the plant. It can induce division in both the region of the plant. Okay, it is produced in the meristem, especially root tip, and then it is transported through xylem to the entire plant. Large amount of cytokinin are found in germinating seed, developing fruit, embryo, etc. Now, we'll see physiological effect. It promotes cell division, thereby it stimulates growth within the plant. It promotes cell division even in non-meristematic cell. Cytokinin is also known as anti-aging hormone. That means it delays senescence in leaves. Okay? Now, how does it delay senescence in leaves? By promoting synthesis of chlorophyll. Okay, it causes expansion of cotyledon. It opposes or it counteracts or inhibits apical dominance. Okay, if cytokinin is applied, even if auxin is present, lateral bud will keep on growing. It is used in tissue culture to induce root and shoot formation. Okay, that is all about cytokinin. Now we have done all three growth promoters. Now we have to do two growth inhibitors. Any question regarding these three? If you have any question, you can ask. Okay, now we'll start with growth inhibitors. These hormone inhibit growth either by increasing the size of the cell or by dividing the cell, by inducing or stimulating cell to undergo mitosis. So that will keep on adding the cell and the growth will be taking place. It is not so. At different part, concentration of hormone are different. Where is Naman gone? Now I'm going to enlist those names which are leaving the class. Okay, after that, the amount of auxin will be reduced. ethylene, chemically ethylene is the only gaseous hormone produced by the plant. And fifth hormone is ABA, abscisic acid. Both are growth inhibitors. So definitely they both are going to cause aging in plant. Both will promote abscission, premature falling of the plant parts. Okay, Pratish also has left. The one and most important question regarding ethylene is that Kushagra. This is the only hormone we have come back. I've removed your name from here. Kushagra has left. We'll have to report it to principal. Gaseous hormone at room temperature. But RA. But Argain in 1934 identified ethylene as the first gaseous plant hormone produced. It is found in tissue of ripened fruit, nodes of the stem, senescent leaf, and flowers. So you can see all the part of the plant that mature produces ethylene. Ethylene is produced in higher plant as well as fungi. All living cells produce ethylene, but meristematic cells produce large amount of ethylene. The effect is, physiological effect of ethylene is, it helps in fruit ripening. If they ask you one, if they ask you one, this is the only effect you are going to write. Ethylene helps in fruit ripening. Second is, it helps in sprouting of potato tubers. Ethylene helps in promote root growth and root hair formation. Induces flowering in mango. In peanut seed, it initiates germination. Ethylene is most widely used hormone in agriculture. Switch off your video, my voice will be clear. That is all about ethylene. Now, abscisic acid. It is growth inhibiting hormone found in few mosses. Mosses belong to bryophytes, pteridophytes, gymnosperm and angiosperm. It is found in chloroplast of leaves, abscisic acid. Okay. Fruits contain highest amount of abscisic acid. Now the physiological effect of abscisic acid. Abscisic acid is also called as stress hormone. When plant is under stress, Now, what type of stress a plant can suffer from? Suppose the plant, the place where the plant is growing is suffering from drought condition. Okay? When there is less water, then what will plant have to do? It will close the stomata. Is it problem for all? Video is paused and you are not able to hear me. Indu, please, you. You check your internet. Okay, thank you. So, the plant will have, I was not talking right now. In between, my video is not paused, I am able to see properly. It is your problem. Your net problem, of course. Now, so what will plant do? It will close stomata, close the guard cell, so that stomata are closed. Now what will happen? Whatever water is there in the plant, it will be conserved. So the stress condition is controlled by, is put under control by abscisic acid. That is why abscisic acid is also called as stress hormone. Have you understood? It is called as stress hormone. Because under condition of stress, plant produces it in large amount. Okay? It causes closure of stomata. It slows down metabolism of plants. Abscisic acid slows down metabolism of the plant, thereby inhibiting growth in plant. It inhibits the germination and development. It induces seed dormancy to overcome unfavorable environmental condition or condition of stress. It causes abscission. What is abscission? One of you write. What is abscission? Very good. Premature falling of plant part is abscission. So, abscisic acid causes abscission. Which hormone prevent abscission? Write down first. Very good. That's all. Okay? I asked from one. Both of them, but oxygen is more effective in preventing abscission. Now, that completes the phytohormone part of this chapter. Chemical coordination. This is a chapter in which you have to learn the name of the five hormones, where are they produced, and what are their physiological effects. Okay? At least 4 to 5 effects you learn. Now we will start with interesting part of this chapter, which is due to hormone, which is called as tropic movement in plant. Okay, we are going to start with the tropic movement. And test you are talking about, even we do not know if there will be a test conducted, you will be told to prepare a particular chapter. Now, this is the last chapter of botany physiology. Shashwat Pandey has left. Shashwat Pandey. Now, we'll start with tropic movements in plant. The movements in plant in the form of growth. The movement in plant in the form of growth. Form of growth in response to a unilateral stimulus, unilateral external stimulus. Now, what is Naman Gupta, you have again left. Now, suppose this is apex of the plant. What is unilateral stimulus? You have to imagine the room in which I am sitting is totally dark. Now, stimulus is given from one direction. Okay? This is called as unilateral stimulus. And this is external stimuli. Okay? So, whatever movement is shown by this plant now is called as tropic movement. Have you understood what tropic movement is? Any plant movement shown as a result of unilateral external stimuli is called as tropic movement. Okay? The direction of the response or movement is related to the direction from which the stimulus comes. And it is called as dhaval. Dhaval. And that is called as tropism. Okay? The direction of response is related all those who will be leaving, I will delete their name from my class at least. I'll find you leaving and not reporting. If you're going for this particular time for drinking water, etc., it is okay. In my class, drinking water is also not allowed. If you can contact your seniors, I don't allow. So, if you go, I will delete your name forever. Direction of response is related to the direction from which the stimulus comes, which is known as tropism. Surya Tehid. Now, let us see the first movement. Shaurya and Shashwat has joined. Phototropism or heliotropism. Shaurya and Shashwat. Phototropism or heliotropism, H-E-L-I-O, is the response of the plant to the unilateral stimulus, which is light. When unilateral stimulus is light, the response of the plant that is shown by it is called as phototropism or heliotropism. Shoot of the plant are positively phototropic, while roots are negatively phototropic. Okay? This response of the plant part, that is root apex and shoot apex, has got a survival value. Shoot of the plant has got chloroplast, so it has to go towards the light so that maximum photosynthesis can take place and the plant can survive well. So the survival value is dependent upon this response, phototropic response of the plant. Am I clear to all? Am I clear to all? Okay. This response of plant is due to or is influenced by the hormone auxin. Now you see, I'm not going to give you this diagram, you have to understand right now. This is a coleoptile, this is a shoot apex, a coleoptile tip, okay, which has been given a unilateral light stimulus. Now auxin is present at the root apex. Now what will happen when the coleoptile tip is exposed to unilateral light stimulus? There is transportation of auxin from the light part, the part which is receiving the light, to the shaded area back of the tip, which is not directly receiving light. Have you understood? Now when auxin reaches to the shaded area, it will cause elongation of cell. Size of the cell will increase here and there will be more growth this side than to the illuminated side, because auxin has been transported to the shaded area. Okay, as a result, shoot tip will move towards or will show more movement towards the light. This is called as phototropic movement. This is another experiment in which the shoot tip has been cut off. When the shoot tip has been cut off, the part of the shoot will not show any effect towards the unilateral light stimulus. Is that clear? So where has auxin moved when unilateral stimulus has been given? Answer me. Where has the auxin moved? dehydration. Yes. That means you have understood. The high concentration of oxygen causes. The high concentration of oxygen causes growth of the shaded side, resulting in bending of the shoot tip towards the light. Okay? That was phototropic or heliotropism. Okay? Now we'll see what is the effect of oxygen in the root, because plant do not have to detect. Plant will show movement. Now let us see. Have you switched off your video? Please switch off your video. Check your internet. They have to trap sunlight for photosynthesis. Their growth will be affected. Now, this is root. Okay, root is negatively phototropic but positively geotropic. This is a part which is part of the root apex. Now here, the effect of oxygen in root and shoot are different. Okay, in root, same concentration of oxygen causes inhibition in growth. What do you mean by inhibition? Delaying or stopping the growth. Okay, while it is causing elongation of stem in the case of shoot apex. Here it will cause inhibition in growth in the root. Now, try to understand without writing any question. This is root apex and unilateral light stimulus is this. By nature, oxygen is going to be transported to shaded area. Now, is that okay? Okay, unilateral light stimulus. Now, oxygen has you know that the, now I'll have to give the instruction, keep your mobile charge also. Naman, are you there? Opposite. Okay? Because of the gravity, auxin has settled down in root as well as shoot. What happens in the case of shoot apex, where auxin is present, it will stimulate growth of the lower part. Okay? It will stimulate growth of the lower part. And so you have to imagine that light is coming from this side. And therefore, there will be more growth of the lower part and the shoot apex will bend towards the light. Okay? In the case of root, where auxin is present, here it is going to inhibit growth of the lower part. There will be more growth on upper part and therefore root will be moving towards the gravity, away from the stimulus of light. Now, the stimulus of light. Oxygen is present down where it is causing growth of the lower part. Therefore, stem will move up, shoot apex will move up. Here, the growth will be inhibited. There will be more growth on the upper part and it will start growing down. Positively phototropic, negatively phototropic. Positively geotropic, negatively geotropic. Clear? Say yes or no. Hydrotropism. It is the movement of plant part in response to water or moisture. If you grow a seedling, the radical part of the seed will move towards the gravity. Okay? Positively geotropic. But if seed and water both are present, if gravity and water both are present, then the radical will start moving towards the water. This is called as hydrotropism. Root always grow in search of water. Water is more important than touch. These are two seeds, and this is a net, a container of made up of net in which moist sawdust are present. Okay, you have put growing seed over here, germinating seed over here. You find in the beginning that the radical keep on moving towards the gravity, showing positively geotropic. After growing to a certain distance, it will start moving up where water is present or where moisture is present. So in this particular diagram, you can show both the movements, geotropic as well as hydrotropic. Plants show more of hydrotropism than of geotropism. their affinity towards water is much more than the affinity towards gravity. Hydrotropism roots grow towards the source of moisture, therefore is positively hydrotropic, while shoots grow away from water and therefore they are negatively hydrotropic. The response of roots to the stimulus of water is stronger than the response to the stimulus of gravity. Now the fourth movement is thigmotropism. Sania, now I'm coming to thigmotropism. Heptotropism. Gauri, are you present? Gauri? Today, is it okay? Endotropism is the growth movement of plant in response to stimulus touch. This is shown where the plants have weak stem. When the stem of the plants are weak, they cannot stand erect, then they show this movement. Okay? Heptotropism or thigmotropism. We happen to see Priyanshi has left. Kushagra has left. Kushagra move a lot. Priyanshi has joined. Plants such as pea, cuscuta and grapevine show this movement. Tendrils which coil around the other plant in response to one-sided contact. Yes, they are immigrant. And yes, money plant also. Your teacher do not like this nature. At least this teacher, she doesn't like. For support, and this is a plant with weak stem. This is a plant with weak stem. Now the tendril can be modified stem also, and the tendril can be modified leaf also. Okay, so here the stem are producing tendril which twines around the strong stem, strong support. This is called as thigmotropism. Now when in this case, when the tip of the tendril moves and touches a strong stem, the stimulus is passed throughout the tendril and the tendril will then, entire tendril will then coil around the support. Okay, this is thigmotropism. The last is chemotropism, which is growth movement due to chemicals. oxidation to take place. So this is called as this. It shows Sturger movement also. This is called as chemotropism. Physiology and circulatory system will be the first chapter which we are going to do. Okay, and make sure that you remain present when we have next class, because that will be very important. All the chapters were important, but when we start with animal physiology, what photosynthesis is to plant physiology, circulatory system is to animal physiology.